Feel free to go.
Hello, everyone. I'm very happy to be here, and thank you for the invitation. I will talk about some of my recent work on the analytic characterization of the dynamics of multipass GD. And now I will have to pretend I have not listened to the last talk, but I will still I will describe it. And in particular, I will focus on a joint work with Pier Francesco Urbani and Lenka Zevorova of this year. So first of all, understanding the dynamics of gradient-based algorithm is, in particular, stochastic gradient descent is a central question in machine learning. Indeed, it has been shown, for instance, in this paper of 2019 by Liu and co-authors, that the landscape of supervised learning problem is far from being trivial, and there are indeed regions of local and even global minima that have poor generalizations, and that gradient descent algorithm can reach if they are initialized in an adversarial way. However, with random initialization, they are able to avoid these bad local and global minima and achieve in practice good generalization properties. And this is not clear why. So for instance, some of the questions that arise are which regions of the landscape are attractive for the algorithm, and in particular, in which cases and what are the characteristics of SGD that make the algorithm better than gradient descent. So in order to understand this problem, it is necessary to characterize somehow the whole trajectory of the algorithm, because the dynamics is being the problem, complex the dynamics is central to understand it. And first, I will overview some of the related works in this direction. So first of all, there are a series of work that try to describe the dynamics of stochastic gradient descent, seeing the algorithm as a noise approximation of gradient descent. A first series of work models the noise as Gaussian, invoking the central limit theorem. And this assumption is questioned in another series of works where the authors observe numerically that in some tasks the noise looks fat-tailed, and so invoke a generalized version of the central limit theorem to characterize the trajectory of the algorithm. More related to my talk is a series of other works that try to model the trajectory of the algorithm without resorting to approximation. And this can be done, but in some specific cases. For the case of gradient descent in linear networks and even deep linear networks, or in the case of online SGD for two-layer neural networks, both with a finite number of hidden layers and in the case of an infinitely wide hidden layer. However, since in practice the algorithm that is applied is a multipass SGD, where the samples are used multiple times, we wanted to try to model directly this scenario. And there is much less theory on this topic. And we managed to derive analytic equations for the dynamics of the algorithm applying dynamical mean field theory from statistical physics in a setting with a general non-convex loss function in the limit of high input dimensions. And in particular, the key ingredients are that we consider that the data are drawn for some specific generative model, and we compute the typical case performance in high dimension. And this was first introduced in our work of last year, and I will talk a bit about some extensions. So the setting is supervised learning, and in particular I will consider the phase retrieval problem, which is an inference problem where the task is to recover a hidden signal from a series of observations. So we have n real measurements that are Gaussian vectors, and the labels are generated by the hidden signal V star. So basically, we have access only to the absolute value of the projection of the data onto the teacher, and not on the phase. In particular, I will consider the case where the teacher weights are spherical. We consider this problem because it is a prototype of an high-dimensional non-convex problem. So a really hard problem, even harder than the typical scenario where neural networks live, where typically there is a wide region of minima. In this case, there is only one global minimum that is very deep, and then a proliferation of bad local minima. And the goal is, of course, to retrieve the vector W. So the learning is done through empirical risk minimization when we have some overall the sample of a loss function that in this case is square loss with an activation function that's the label squared simply because we do not have access to the phase. And then we can add regularization, which can either be ridge, or in this case, we will consider a spherical constraint. The optimization algorithm is SGD. So in general, the weights are updated in the direction of the gradient, but this gradient is computed only on a subset B of samples that is updated at each time. So we can rewrite the algorithm introducing a binary variable S mu associated to each sample, and its evolution defines the sampling protocol. In particular, to our analytic characterization, we choose a slight variant of the SGD algorithm that we call persistent SGD. And in particular, the difference is that in this case, the process for the labels S mu in the continuous time limit is a Poisson process. The average fraction of samples that are used to compute the gradient is fixed, but in general, the mini batch size can fluctuate. And also the samples are used in the gradient for a typical time. So there is a notion of persistency in this sampling procedure that introduces a memory that normally is not there. And in addition, we consider different initializations. So first, random initialization. And then we focus on an informed initialization that in this case, we simply plug by initializing the algorithm in the direction of the signal with a fixed projection M0. But then this is not unrealistic because in practice, it is what is really done in applications, and this informed initialization can be achieved, for instance, via spectral methods. And we use this M0 as an extra parameter to probe the landscape of the problem. The performance, being the weights spherical, is entirely encoded in the magnetization. That is our order parameter, that's the simply the projection of the weights on the hidden signal. So in practice, What is done to solve this problem is considering informed utilization and trimming strategies that, or other regularizations on the loss. So in particular, trimming consists in putting a cutoff on the activation function. However, recent works have shown that even from random initializations and without resorting to this trick, phase retrieval, even the phase retrieval problem can be solved for enough number of samples, even by gradient descent. So our questions were, can SGD improve significantly over gradient descent, and at which sample complexity? So in this case, we consider linear sample complexity, where the number of samples over the dimension is fixed, and the times that are not exponential in the system size, but are large, but still tractable. So in particular, our derivation involves the application of dynamical mean field theory, which is an analytic framework that's been used many times in statistical physics to describe the dynamics of a large number of the interacting degrees of freedom. In particular, for the random perceptron problem in the context of spin glasses, this framework has been applied by Agoritsas et al. And al. And then we've generalized this case to multipass SGD and structured data in 2020. So basically, I won't go into the details of the derivation of dynamical mean field theory, but in a nutshell, this formalism allows to perform a dimensional reduction. So we start from a Markovian dynamics of a huge number of degrees of freedom tending to infinity, and we reduce it to a dynamics of just a few effective degrees of freedom that really capture the performance of the algorithm in time, at the price of adding memory to the dynamics. So we start from the continuous time limit of the stochastic gradient descent equations. And this is why we have defined the persistent variant of SGD in order to have a well defined continuous time limit. And we end up with the dynamics of an effective, we have an effective stochastic process, H of T. So it's a scalar variable that encodes the projection of the weights onto the noise in the data. And then we have an ODE for the order parameter M, that is the, again, the projection of the weights onto the signal. This equation is quite tricky. These equations are quite tricky to solve because they depend on a set of memory kernels and correlation kernels, and also some auxiliary functions that are in turn averages over the stochastic process. So basically, they must be solved in a self-consistent way by iterations. But in the end, we observe that they can capture very well the dynamics of the algorithm at the advantage of being in the infinite dimensional limit. So in this case, in this particular problem, for instance, where finite size effect can be huge, being able to track the dynamics in the infinite dimensional limit give us a control over the simulations. And indeed, first we compare our results for just the gradient descent algorithm, and we find that The theory in red has a very good agreement with the simulations that are performed at dimension 1000. So here we plot the average magnetization as a function of the training time. Here is the continuous time. And first of all, what we can observe is that even at a finite initial magnetization, for instance, 0.5 in the left plot, we still have that the algorithm is stuck even very close to the signal. So it can be stuck even at magnetization 0.9. So like the first thing that we observe is that a warm start is not enough to achieve perfect recovery. And then we perform some numerical simulations at fixed landscape. And we plot different realization of the curves. And again, we observe that the landscape is really complicated. Indeed, for instance, we see that more informed initializations do not guarantee better performance, and also that some regions can be trapping even if they're very close to the signal. For instance, if we look at the bottom right figure, we have that all simulations starting at the magnetization 0.8 achieve perfect recovery. While if we achieve magnetization 0.8 dynamically, we see that in the left and central plots that many realizations can still get stuck below perfect recovery. And this was a bit surprising. Furthermore, we compare the performance of GD with the SGD. And we observe that the persistent SGD has a huge improvement over the GD algorithm. Here we plot again the average magnetization over as a function of time. And indeed, we see that this additional noise allows to introduce a sort of built-in annealing in the algorithm that automatically can reach perfect recovery even at very low sample complexity. And if we look at the different realizations for different algorithms, so GD in red, vanilla SGD in green, and persistent SGD in blue, we see that tuning the persistence time, we can avoid the algorithm to get stuck in plateau. And we also see that the performance of SGD is significantly better than the one of GD starting from random initialization. And okay, we can also explore the role of the parameters. And maybe a bit surprisingly, we observe that for the range of parameters that we have analyzed in this problem, the best setting is a finite persistence time, while infinitesimal persistence time would correspond to SGD, and also a finite fraction of samples in the training mini batch, while vanilla SGD usually as an infinitesimal fraction. And so I'm a bit out of time, so I will conclude with some open questions that that we are investigating. So first thing would be to gain more insights from the DMFT. So try to characterize the noise introduced by stochastic gradient descent and why it is beneficial, and also gain some insights on optimal parameter setting. Then this model can be extended to other data models where I have not specified it, but I think it was clear it was a one layer neural network, and this could be extended to networks with I would say most wanted unit. And also we could consider some variants of the algorithm. Indeed, in a recent work, Mannelli and Urbani have derived some equations, DMFT equations for momentum, gradient descent plus momentum. And we could try to see if there is an improvement if one does SGD and momentum. And finally, also the rigorous proofs of the equation could be a further direction of research. And I think I will stop here. Thank you for your attention.